Hi guys, welcome to the new session of RBI 24/7. My name is Mansi Anand and I extend a warm welcome to you all. So guys, I hope that you all are doing great and let's not waste any time and move straight away to question number 1. But before doing that, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if this is the first video that you are watching, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button. You can also press this bell icon which is flashing here on the screen. It can help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up. Then you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So moving ahead to question number 1. Okay, so here is the question number 1. And this question, it gives you some statements about a topic called adventure capitalists. And you have to select the correct statement, right? So moving ahead to the answer for this question, and correct option for this question is option D. Option D means 1 and 3 are correct. So 1 and 3 are correct and 2 is not correct. So guys, first of all, talking about this term which is called adventure capitalist, and here I am not talking about the game with the same name which looks something like this, right? So see, if we remove AD from adventure, it becomes venture capitalist. So this is the main word, and we have discussed the meaning of venture capitalists many times in our videos, right? So venture capitalist is an entity, is a business that invests in new businesses, which sees potential in young businesses and thinks that, okay, this is a business that needs help, that needs financial resources to grow, and helps them to grow and later sells them off at profit. So those are venture capitalists which invest into young businesses. Now we are making this venture turn into adventure. So see, venture capitalists, they already have good risk appetite, they are taking risks, but when you add adventure to it, then they become more risk taking entities. Basically, see, if we say that all venture capitalists, they have risk taking appetite, they are risk taking entities, so the top ones out of them who can take more risk than the other venture capitalists, they are known as adventure capitalists, right? So they are obviously, they want investing, but apart from that, they are also in need of some adventure, right? Okay, so some more information about this topic of adventure capitalists. Here you can see, colloquially used to describe venture capital investors who have particularly high risk tolerances, right? They become actively involved in the companies they invest in. So one point here is, because they are investing so much money into potentially new companies or into companies or into industries which are unheard of, right? So if we talk about companies which are working in the field of fintech, or they are coming up with some health startups, right? So see, these type of companies, be it edtech, be it health tech or fintech, so these are common now. You are hearing about such startups. But if we go 5 to 7 years back, this type of fields did not exist, at least not for a common man, right? So those companies who were investing them into that time, they were taking a high risk. That is why they have to be involved in the company they are investing into, because they want to take high risks, right? And being actively involved in their management allows them to provide their expertise to these young startups, which they can use to their benefit, right? VC investors, known for their high risk tolerances, generally focus on companies pursuing disruptive technologies, seek to become pioneers in the emerging industries. So as I told you, they invest in emerging industries, right? So which have high risk, but they are also having high reward potential, right? So this is one major point here, that where a normal investor sees lack of an existing industry, a venture capitalist, specifically an adventure capitalist, he might see that this is a potential or this is an opportunity. So where others see risk, adventure capitalists, they see opportunity, right? They see the potential for individual companies to become market leader, right? So nowadays we are talking so much about social media. We have so many apps that can connect us to our friends or to random strangers where you can be friends with them, right? So we have a lot of social media apps. But if you go 10 to 15 years back, this was all unheard of, and this was a considerably new field. So investors who put their money into Facebook or into Google when they came out, so they were taking high risks, right? So that is why they identify the emerging industries, or they identify particular companies which can be a benchmark or which can set some norms for a growing industry or for some emerging industries, right? Okay, so one point here is, since these adventure capitalists, they take high risks, they invest into high risk opportunities, obviously most of their ventures are not going to be successful. But the point is, the few ones which become really successful, they compensate for all the loss making entities, right? So there are less companies in which they invest, they become successful, but if they become exceptionally successful, then they can compensate. That is why you can see here, statement 1 is correct. Generally support companies in emerging industries. Investors have an eye for ventures providing extraordinary returns for their early investors. So being an early investor and availing the benefit of a first mover advantage is very important, right? Second statement is not correct, because it says these companies are likely to succeed. They are very unlikely to succeed. That is why I told you that some become exceptionally or extraordinary high return industries or high return companies, right? So moving ahead to the second question. Second question for today says, the Dash is an economy built around creators with a purpose. People who are powerfully motivated to start a brand, business or community, usually on digital platforms. Moving ahead to correct option for this question. Correct option for this question is option C. Option C means passion economy. So here, if you look at the definition, you might find some words like purpose. Here is also purpose. But the point is, it is not necessary that if there is a particular word mentioned in the definition, it has to be the actual name. So this sort of structure is known as passion economy. Why passion economy? Because they are talking about combining two things, passion and money, or passion or profit making opportunities. See, we are usually told that you can either follow your heart or you can print money, right? So if you want to indulge into money making activities, then you should not follow your heart, and you should give up your passion and follow the most taken path or the most taken road. But this is not true in today's world, because we can see many people who have taken up unconventional careers, who have turned such sort of opportunity, such sort of risks into profit making ventures, right? So I think one example that we can take here is Instagram influencers. Right, so we can see many young people who have turned into a rage for young children, right? The point is that they have followed their heart and they are now making money out of it. They post their pictures, they motivate the people, their particular, their target audience, and these audience, when they like them, they sort of commercialize this influence that they have on their target audience, right? So the point is, today we live in a dynamic world where you can always turn your passion into a profit making opportunity, right? So for following your passion, it is not necessary that you should let money go, and you should think that how to combine both the things and come up with something special, something unique, which is unheard of, right? So these Instagram influencers, once they start becoming popular, once they go viral, their videos go viral, they start getting offers from companies for modeling, they get chances to inaugurate some new retail stores or to model for but established brands. Apart from that, they make money through YouTube, they make money through Instagram. So the point is, they turn into celebrities just by having influence. So if you are able to influence people, if you are able to generate an audience, then you will be able to turn it into a profit making entity. Although there is no stability in such careers, because you never know till when audience is going to remember you, but depending upon the capability of the person, that person can turn a risk or a passion into an opportunity, right? So this is passion economy, which is, see, this is just one example. We can take many examples. For example, Byju's, which was a pioneer in the field of online education, right? So we can take so many examples. Now e-pharmacy startups have also started to come up. Health has also integrated with technology, where there are apps which provide people with medical consultancy, right? So basically, people are trying to innovate. And how are they trying to innovate? Combining their passion with a need, or with identifying a particular need in the market which they can turn into a profitable opportunity, right? So people who are powerfully motivated to start a brand. Another example can be podcasts, which are very popular. People who have good communication skills, who can influence people, can earn money through this, and they can actually become a brand. So becoming a brand, see, not just goods and services can become a brand, but a particular person can also be a brand. So people who are motivated to start powerful brands, business, or communities, usually availing the benefit of technology. So that is passion economy. Okay. Ongoing demand for three things: expertise, experiences, and relationship. So you have to be an expert in a particular area. So that can be any area, be it your communication skills, be it fashion, be it lifestyle. So if you travel the world and share your experiences with public and they like it, then you are going to become an influencer for them, right? So having some expertise about a particular field, and then sharing your experiences, making them relatable for the public, and establishing a relationship with them. So digital platforms overcome the roadblock of geography and time zones. Where is technology helpful? Tackling these problems of geography. So someone situated in USA can connect to someone sitting in India, or can connect to someone sitting in a remote African village, right? Due to internet. Okay, most importantly, allow people to connect and build relationships that maintain and fuel this passion economy. So what is fueling, what is driving this passion economy? Relationships. When people feel that a certain, that the problems or the experiences that a certain person is having, they can also relate to that, they can also connect to that, then they start following a particular person. Definition was coined in a book called The Passion Economy by Adam Davidson. He argues that in today's economic setting, passion and profit, they can go hand in hand. They are not mutually exclusive. So aren't opposites, but elements that go hand in hand and can turn into successful businesses. Okay. So here you can see passion economy has three main elements. The creator, basically the person who's trying to convert their passion into profitable opportunity and is having a unique skill, idea, topic or a passion. Digital platform, which is key for supporting these type of passion activities, and the market. So if we talk about Instagram influencer, so the influencer is the creator. Instagram or platforms such as Snapchat, earlier TikTok used to be really popular, so all these can be our digital platforms. Who is the market? The public who is following them, right? So this is passion economy. So I'm just remembering an example. I was reading it somewhere. So it's about a lady who had to quit her job because she had kids, and when her kids grew up, she was missing her job, and rather than coming into a corporate job, she started a business venture of her own. She really liked folding things and making things out of the origami art. So she started coming up with ideas for developing cards, invitation cards, or cards for birthday parties of kids, right? So she turned this passion of hers, which was basically dormant in her for a long time, and turned it into a profitable business venture. Okay, third question. This question says, what does it refer to here? It basically two statements given to you. You have to identify the meaning of it here. Correct option for this question is option A. Option A means ombudsman. So here we are talking about a person who is responsible for solving many problems. What type of problems? Complaints against businesses and other organizations, including the government. See, ombudsman is basically a grievance redressal mechanism where people who are stressed or who have been facing problems because of any third party, they can go and find a solution to their problem. That person, that entity is ombudsman. Typically has a broad mandate, allows him or her to address overarching concerns, the public, and sometimes the private sector. So if anyone is having problem with any government department, they are not able to find problem to a solution, then they can go to a respective ombudsman that has been made responsible for their jurisdiction, right? And they can also investigate against private sector. So you can understand ombudsman as an unofficial cop, or you can say an unofficial detective who goes on investigating. Okay. Ombudsman, official, usually appointed by government, investigates complaints against businesses, financial institutions, or even government departments or public entities, and attempts to solve the conflicts first by mediation. They don't want every small case, every small conflict going into courts. That is why they try to resolve it at a smaller level. So either by mediation or by making any recommendations. So can be called by different names in different areas. When appointed, the ombudsman is typically paid by the method of some fees, right? So this person, since he or she is trying to resolve the problems, he gets some remuneration. Large public entity or any other organization may have their own ombudsman. So if there is a very big organization working at a large scale, then they can have their own grievance redressal mechanism in form of a person or in form of a responsible executive who can solve the problems of public relating to that particular entity. Ombudsman is a good but underutilized and misunderstood grievance redressal options for insurance companies. So recently there was an article in Live Mint about ombudsman. Just a second. Okay. So recently there was an article in LiveMint about the utility of an ombudsman in the insurance sector. So in insurance sector, we see that people have been witnessing many concerns relating to the insurance companies, whether it is related to their claims that have not been provided by companies, or whether it is related to some sort of bad conduct which has been shown by companies. So that article suggested that an ombudsman can be a good mechanism to connect people to these insurance companies, basically bridging the gap or trying to resolve the conflicts at a smaller level, right? But the problem here is people are usually unaware. So lack of information is one problem here, and people have to be made aware that who is this person, who is this ombudsman, who is responsible, or who can solve these problems. Many times people are unaware of existence of such an entity, right? Okay, sorry. So moving ahead to the next question, question number 4. This question says, select the statement which is correct about a cryptocurrency wallet, right? 5 statements given to you have to select the correct one, and correct statement for this question is option E. Option E means cold wallets are less vulnerable to cyber attacks than hot wallets. For understanding this question, we should know about the meaning of the word cryptocurrency wallet and what are the type of wallets that are being talked about here. Okay, first of all, what is a wallet? See, we have a particular wallet in which we keep our money, right? Except some people. Okay, so we have wallets, and in that wallet we keep our money. But what about a cryptocurrency wallet? So an online wallet or a digital wallet in which you can store your crypto in which you can save your crypto assets like Bitcoin or any other cryptocurrency that you are investing into. You can save these sort of investments into a particular storage area, and that storage area is known as a cryptocurrency wallet. Helps you to store crypto assets and tokens. So it can be a separate device, or it can be a software program on your phone. Now, where to store it? What is the form of this particular storage device? It can be a separate device. Just as you have a wallet in which you can put your money, you can have a separate device posing as your wallet. And rather than having a separate device, you can store it on your phones or your computers, your laptops, or on an online cloud mechanism. Usually they utilize blockchain technology to safely and securely store the crypto assets, as well as facilitate the transfer of such assets. So you need an area where you can calculate how much crypto assets have you transferred, or if you have received some assets from any place. You need a particular storage area to maintain these assets. Right, these wallets can be classified into two categories: hot wallets, which run through online mechanisms, and cold wallets, which are not connected to internet and they can be used offline as well. Right, so hot wallets online, cold wallets not connected to internet. See, you can see here, can be accessed anytime. Include online cloud wallets, most mobile wallets, software wallets, and crypto exchanges. So if there is a crypto exchange where you're maintaining your account and there you are keeping all your crypto asset, that also comes under the purview of hot wallets. So there are cloud wallets when you store your crypto assets in an online form on a particular online storage mechanism, such as a cloud mechanism. I hope we all are aware about the cloud services. These have been gaining popularity, especially during the COVID period, right? If there is a specific software that stores wallet, or if the assets are stored in mobile, right? Coming to cold wallets, they can be in the form of hardware or paper wallets. So hardware, when there is an external device, I told you it can be in the form of a separate device. Or paper wallets, when you have documents or when you have information mentioned on pieces of paper, then you can use cold wallets. Now coming to the safety aspect, see, cold wallets are much more safer than hot wallets. Why is it so? Because cold wallets are not storing your data, is not storing your asset on an online mechanism. But if you store it under any mode, under the hot wallet, be it any online cloud facility, or if you store it in a particular software, then being online, it is more vulnerable to any sort of cyber attack. That is why cold wallet is safer as compared to hot wallet, right? So I hope you understand the difference. Here you can see online or web wallets more susceptible to online attacks and scams. If you can use crypto exchanges, so crypto exchanges also part of hot wallets, you need to be sure that safety is maintained in regard to your assets, right? So this is the difference between hot and cold. Now you must be wondering that why are hot wallets used when cold wallets are safer? Because it is difficult to store in cold wallets when you are having a large number of transactions. If you are having so many transactions, then it becomes cost effective to store in a hot wallet rather than going for a cold wallet, right? So that is a trade-off. So hot wallets lets you store large number of transaction and is cost effective but less secure. Cold wallets more secure but costlier, right? So that is why the correct statement was option E, where it is said that cold wallets are less vulnerable to cyber attacks than hot wallets. Okay, moving ahead to the last question for today. So this is the last question, which says Prem Kumar Gonsalves is having an idea about an entrepreneurial venture, but the details are not figured out as of now. He is thinking to apply for a government funded program that can help him with development of his idea and further steps like prototyping, selection of a target customer base and business planning. What type of program do you think Gonsalves is thinking to join? Basically, a case given to you about a person who is interested in an entrepreneurial venture. Correct option for this question is option B. Option B means incubator. Just a second. Okay. So, incubator. Here we are going to talk about two things. First is incubator and the other one is accelerator. So, these are nothing but these are just programs which are meant for helping out startups, right? So the young companies or the startups which are facing some problems, these two types of programs, incubators and accelerators, they are meant to help them. See, the name tells you, first of all, incubate. So incubator lets the entrepreneur to incubate the idea, and accelerator allows to increase the speed of growth, right? So incubator works on a beginning stage where it helps entrepreneur to develop the idea. See, if anyone has a faint idea but they are not sure how to go about this idea, how to develop the product, or they need any tech help with that, in that case incubator can help that particular entrepreneur. So these two terms are usually used interchangeably, but there is difference. So incubator majorly focused on ideas and innovation. How you can provide the best value offering, best utility for your customers. So that is why this particular person, Prem Gonsalves, is talking about an incubator program, because he has a faint idea and he wants to develop that idea before making it commercial or before talking about its growth, right? When all these things are developed, now you have a particular product offering, you know that what is your target customer base, you know how to offer your products and services, then comes the turn of accelerator. Now these accelerator programs, they help startups. So all those startups who have passed through this stage, see, there might be many companies which have passed through this stage, which are having a proper business plan, then they need the help of accelerator, which can help them to grow their business in form of developing marketing strategies for them, or if they need some extra funding for expansion, right? So these are accelerator programs. Okay, here you can see some more differences. Accelerator focusing on scaling a business. So these are basically scale ups. Usually have a set time frame in which individual companies spend, right? So they usually have a set time frame ranging from a few months working with some mentors to build out the business and avoid problems along the way. Accelerators, they get a lot of applications and they are very selective. They select that which startup they want to help. And after that, incubators, more focused on ideas and innovations, begin with companies that may be earlier in the process and do not operate on a set schedule because they do not know how much time they need to develop the idea of a particular company, right? So they do not work on a, usually they do not work on a fixed schedule. Incubator can be focused in a specific market or specific vertical. Let's say if there is a particular hospital who is sponsoring an incubator program, then it might help out the health tech startups or any e-pharmacy startup. So they can belong to a particular industry or they can be open in nature, then any industry-based startup can contact them. Provide mentorship that allows these startups to perform customer discovery, prototyping, develop their product and to plan out their business, right? So this is the difference between an accelerator and an incubator. Okay. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then do not forget to hit the like button because I'll be back in next session with some new information. So guys, before ending the session, I would like to take a few doubts. So many of you were having some problem with a topic that we discussed, that was how are magnetic cards less safer than NFC technology, right? See, there are many reasons. First of all, the NFC technology, it works on a contactless mode of payment. See, in magnetic card, you have to swipe the card in a POS machine. And there have been many cases, basically scam or fraud cases, where it has been found that many hackers, what do they do? Sorry. So these hackers, they fix some sort of data retriever or some sort of applications on devices like POS machines or ATM machines, and they fix some devices in these type of devices in these machines and they can retrieve data from here. So a magnetic card has to make contact with a POS machine in order to allow the customer to make a payment, right? So, but NFC is based on a contactless technology. Apart from that, magnetic cards, as I told you in that session also, they usually work on a signature platform, and signatures are not that safe because it is easy to replicate signatures, right? And usually the merchants, they do not even check these signatures properly, so it is easy to replicate signatures. Whereas in NFC, there is less probability that signature is going to be valid. In usually NFC technology transactions, what happens is there is another layer of authentication which is known as AFA, additional factor of authentication, right? We have studied about this in one of our previous session. So this can be in the form of an OTP which will be sent to a connected mobile number, or it can be in the form of a PIN, which is not that easy to replicate as compared to signatures, right? So NFC usually, so the larger amount transactions, they come with additional factor of authentication, right? And one more point is here, and that point is NFC can be connected to wallets. NFC can be connected to devices like mobile phones or wearables like smartwatch, right? So if you have such devices that have the capacity to handle NFC technology, you do not even physically need your card. You can leave your card at home and make the payment using a mobile phone, bringing in close proximity, or in simple terms, bringing your mobile phone near the device that merchant uses to read the data or to allow you to make the payment, right? So such factors make NFC much secure than magnetic cards. So I hope now this doubt is solved, and guys, I'll see you in the next session. Till then, you take care of yourselves. It's really cold, so try taking care of yourselves and carry on your studies. I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.